Hey everyone, Jake here from CVP. Today we're taking a look at this, the Fujifilm X-H2S, Fujifilm's new flagship X-series mirrorless camera. The X-H1 was Fuji's first attempt at making a video-focused hybrid camera, and the X-H2S is Fujifilm's latest attempt at that. But how does it perform? What is it like to use? And is it a serious contender at the £2,500 price point? Let's take a look. I know we were a little bit late to the party with this one, and we did get the camera early before the embargo from Fuji. However, we now have our full production demo unit, which is free from the bugs and issues that we had with the pre-release camera. We've shot a couple of things with the X-H2S over the time we've had it, so we'll be sprinkling shots as well as some different tidbits from our time shooting with the camera throughout the video. The X-H2S features Fuji's 5th generation X-Trans sensor with a resolution of 6240 by 4160, a size of 23.5 by 15.6 millimeters, and a pixel pitch of 3.77 microns. This is quite a normal sized APS-C sensor, so most APS-C and S35 coverage lenses should work. The sensor is stacked, which helps with the speed of the readout possible when shooting stills and video. This paired with the improved backend processing, which is actually twice as powerful as the 4th generation processing from Fuji, results in improved frame rate options over the previous generation sensor, as well as better rolling shutter performance, which we'll look at in a bit. The X-H2S also features a 14-bit sensor readout mode when shooting video, which is quite rare to see in consumer mirrorless cameras, but has been featured on more expensive cinema cameras. This should help the camera capture higher dynamic range than its mirrorless counterparts. Just bear in mind, when in the higher frame rate modes, the camera will automatically switch back to 12-bit. Another feature that not many cameras offer at this price point is open gate recording. It's great to see the ability to record 6K 3x2 up to 30p in 4210-bit internally. You can then either window in on your sensor or keep your full field of view in the camera's 4K and 1080p modes or downsampling, which should result in an improvement of image quality. Depending on your frame rate choice, you will see cropping in which Fuji have noted on this format chart here. With the pursuit of more dynamic range with the X-H2S, Fuji have released a new log gamma curve profile, F-Log2, which should allow for the capture of up to 14 stops of dynamic range. You can still use the original F-Log profile, which you may want to do if the base ISO of F-Log2 is too high for your scene. In F-Log2, the base ISO is 1250, in its standard modes it's 160, and in F-Log it's 640. When using any log curve, you will experience more noise than shooting a regular gamma curve, but this is a trade-off you have to make for more dynamic range. Just make sure you expose well and maybe apply a bit of noise reduction in post and you'll be fine. ISO 1250 isn't that high for a base ISO, but you will 100% need an ND solution to shoot outside, so make sure to get one if you're planning on grabbing this camera. With this new log curve comes a new range of LUTs from Fujifilm, as F-Log LUTs will not work correctly. These include several different decent utility LUTs and a couple of alternate options too. You can download them via the link in the description. Buried deep in the menu system, there is an F-Log View Assist mode, which is helpful for when you're shooting in F-Log. When you select which profile you want to shoot in, you can change between film emulation, F-Log, F-Log2, and HLG. When it comes to color science, Fujifilm are well known for their filmic color profiles, and the X-H2S has plenty of options to not only shoot log like we mentioned, but also a good range of different color profiles, some of which are designed for stills, and some of which are more designed for video acquisition. When you are in the film simulation mode, you can choose from 13 different simulations. Obviously, this is going to be personal preference, but Fuji have added two eternal looks, cinema and a bleach bypass. Past these profiles, you can also tweak several parameters such as a tone curve, color and sharpness to really dial in the image you want. In the standard mode, you can also toggle between three different dynamic range modes, 100, 200 and 400%. This makes a massive difference in stills mode, in JPEG and RAW, and in video, as the process is done before the data hits the analog to digital converter. This requires higher ISOs than the base in this standard mode. So 100% is 160, 200% is 320, and 400% is 640. 100% is off, 200% is one extra stop, and 400% is two stops extra. Auto will switch on the fly between 100 and 200%. This will increase the noise in your shadows, but does provide much more highlight retention. This could be a good option for people wanting to capture quick turnaround imagery without compromising the dynamic range the camera can capture. Depending on what log curve you are in, will change whether or not the camera is set to 12-bit or 14-bit. F-Log being 12-bit and F-Log 2 being 14-bit. This changes the rolling shutter performance quite a bit, going from around 11 milliseconds in F-Log 2 to about 5.5 milliseconds in F-Log. It performs really well here, especially compared to the Pocket 6K and the Sony FX30, which are two of its closest competitors, and it also performs better than the X-H2, but that's not surprising given the 2's higher resolution sensor. When it comes to latitude, we thought we'd take a look at how the X-H2S compares to some other cameras at its price point. So we grabbed the Pocket 6K Pro, Sony A7 IV, FX3 and FX30, and the Panasonic GH6. The X-H2S has all of the noise reduction turned off for this testing. Each camera is rated at its lowest base ISO, and we used an Otis 55mm f1.4 and dealt with the difference in exposure between the cameras using shutter speed. Given that we had different sensor sizes as well, we moved the camera to adjust the subject and chart size in the frame, and all shots were normalized in resolve. Looking at overexposure, the X-H2S does well up to 4 stops, where Sam's skin is held pretty well, and so is the chart. As we go from 4 to 6 stops, we can start to see colors clip, as well as Sam's skin. The X-H2S performs well at 4 compared to its competition, though the Pocket 6K looks a touch better thanks to the highlight recovery possible in B-RAW, and the FX3 looks a touch better here too. Though considering the sensor size difference, I think the X-H2S performs very well here. Looking at under, at 4 stops, color is held pretty well, but past that, things get very noisy. Compared to the other cameras, I think it looks good. However, I do think that the FX3 and the A7 IV look the best when it comes to noise and color, but compared to the other cameras, the X-H2S looks good. In the X-H2S, you can go into the menu and dial in 2 different noise reduction parameters: high ISO noise reduction and inter-frame noise reduction. Inter-frame noise reduction can be toggled on or off and uses the data differences between adjacent frames to reduce noise, similar to temporal noise reduction. This mode is best used for static shots, as with faster moving images, you can get some ghosting artifacts. Whereas high ISO noise reduction is more traditional tweakable noise reduction that you can dial in between 9 different levels depending on what your planned workflow is. Noise reduction is always a balance of usable dynamic range, detail and noise. So what you need to dial in will change depending on your needs and workflow. Normally for faster turnaround projects, you'll want to apply your noise reduction in camera. Whereas for more controlled projects, where you have the time to do noise reduction in post, having the flexibility of doing this may be beneficial. As with most cameras, even with noise reduction fully turned down, there does still seem to be some going on. We can see a clear step in noise reduction around a stop and a third above your chosen gamma base ISO. It's not the same level as the base ISO, so probably why Fuji aren't calling it a dual native ISO sensor, but it's worth knowing about. When we initially had a pre-production camera, we did run into a bug when using noise reduction in camera when shooting F-Log 2. The live image on the back of the camera became really soft, which meant hitting sharps was really hard. This honestly made the camera almost unusable unless you had turned off the noise reduction completely. In this full production unit, this is no longer the case, which is great to see as it was a deal breaker for us then. When it comes to low light performance, I would say that you can get pretty usable results in F-Log 2 up to around 4000-ish ISO. While the camera doesn't feature an OLPF, it does use some trickery to help control moiré and false color artifacts. We've recorded every format of our chart, and we can easily see the detail and moiré difference between the different formats. We won't be playing all these clips here, they are all included in our long uncut tests video over on our Vimeo. The 6K footage has the least amount of aliasing and the most amount of discernible detail. And as you go down the resolutions, you will see worse moiré and less detail. The X-H2S features in-body image stabilization, which Fuji states should provide up to 7 stops of stabilization. There are also plenty of lenses with optical image stabilization built in, and the camera also has a digital stabilization feature which will crop in a little bit and provide even more stabilization power, though this is limited to just up to 60p. This is good for locked off shots, but not while walking or any kind of movement. The performance of the IBIS is alright, but not quite as good as some of its competition. When it comes to recording formats, there is an absolute bunch available. You can record in a mix of different resolutions from 6K 3x2 all the way down to 1080p at a range of frame rates in both 16 and 17x9 aspect ratios. Depending on what resolutions you are in, you can record in 3 different flavors of ProRes internally as well. You've got HQ, 42 and LT. and then H.265 and H.264 in either all light or long op compression. There are so many choices that it actually can be a little bit confusing for someone who is new to filmmaking to look at. ProRes is an industry standard codec and will result in larger file sizes but good quality, and it will also perform better in post than H.265 rushes will. H.264 will perform better but is limited to 4:8-bit, which isn't ideal when shooting in F-Log 2. This is a really good comprehensive set of options for a hybrid mirrorless camera to offer internally. There is a good range of base frame rates across each different recording format, which includes 23.98 and 24p. When it comes to higher frame rate recording, the camera has a high speed mode. This will allow you to record DCI 4K up to 120p in 10-bit 422 and 2K up to 240 frames per second, also in 10-bit 422. You can choose from a range of different formats and compressions here depending on what you need. It seems like more and more mirrorless cameras are putting full-size HDMI ports into their cameras, and the X-H2S follows that trend as well. You can output 6K up to 29.97p, as well as resolutions down to Full HD. When in the camera's high speed mode, which you will need to be in the HDMI recording only mode, you can output DCI 4K up to 120p in 4:2 10-bit, but there will be a 1.29x crop. You can also output RAW, which can be captured in either ProRes RAW or Blackmagic RAW. Having the choice to shoot either of these is great, as no matter what workflow you are tied into, you can shoot RAW. You will need a Ninja 5 or 5 Plus for ProRes RAW and either a Video Assist 12G HDR 5-inch or 7-inch. You can output 6K 3x2 up to 29.97 or 4.8K 60x9 up to 59.94p. This will, however, window in on the sensor by roughly 1.3x, down from the 6K frame. Both of these options are 12-bit, whereas the camera is limited to 10-bit formats internally. This should help take advantage of the 14-bit readout. When it comes to anamorphic options, I think Fuji could have pushed a little bit more into this camera. The OpenGate 3x2 will allow for better anamorphic acquisition options than a 16x9 sensor, and when used with a 1.5x anamorphic will result in roughly a 2.25:1 aspect ratio without any cropping, and of course, this is 6K, so you do have resolution to play with while still delivering to 4K, so you can crop. However, currently, as of the release of this video, the X-H2S doesn't have any specific anamorphic D-squeeze options for monitoring in camera or anamorphic stabilization, which can be found in Panasonic's mirrorless cameras. So if you do want to shoot anamorphic on the X-H2S, make sure to grab an external monitor that can D-squeeze your desired squeeze factor. The X-H2S doesn't have any 30-minute record limit, but instead is limited by its cooling and media. As with any mirrorless camera, cooling everything inside of the camera is crucial for improving runtimes and performance of the system. As with loads of other mirrorless cameras, there is also an auto power off temp function that you can toggle between standard and high to extend recording times. The X-H2S is weather sealed, which means that it isn't anywhere for a cooling fan to push hot air out of. Heat is dissipated passively via its body, and this does mean that there is a chance the camera can overheat when shooting video in certain scenarios. Fuji's solution to this is the addition of the optional fan attachment for the rear of the camera. This mounts using the two thumb screws here, just make sure to remove this little cover here first. I can really see people losing this little cover pretty easily. Luckily, Fujifilm sent a replacement cover set which includes this in case you do misplace it. Once mounted, it does stick out quite a bit, but it is built from very similar material to the camera, so it does feel pretty well built and kind of like an extension of the camera. Unsurprisingly, it does restrict you from putting the monitor back into its normal position. But luckily, it is easy and fast to mount, so storing your camera safely with it removed is not a huge concern. You can move the monitor around fully with it attached. It does sit nicely with the monitor turned facing the operator's side, which could result in some cool configurations with larger rigs. You can then control the fan in the menu. Here you can choose between off, low or high constant speeds, and then auto 1 and 2. Auto 1 prioritizes low fan noise, and auto 2 prioritizes camera temperature. On high, you can definitely hear the fan doing its job. This reminds me of the setups used on the Panasonic S1H or GH6, but obviously it's now removable. I guess this could be seen as a good or a bad thing. The camera isn't as bulky, and you also get weather sealing, or you then have the option to use this if you want to or not. It's available separately to the camera and will cost you an extra £170. Let us know in the comments if you think this was a smart choice by Fuji or not. Lens choice is a really important part of any camera purchasing decision, and Fuji have got a good range for their X-mount ecosystem. However, when it comes to autofocus performance, some are better than others. The newer lenses will have faster, more accurate motors, which will result in a much better experience than some of their older lenses. This does limit which lenses will take advantage of the improved autofocus performance of the X-H2S. Fuji have actually recommended 3 zoom lenses as their official best lenses when it comes to a balance of autofocus, breathing, and stabilization performance for video. The 10-24 f4, 18-55 f2.8 to f4, and 50-140mm f2.8. With more to join them, I'm sure. With our demo unit, we grabbed the 16-55mm f2.8 to f4 and the 33mm f1.4 LMWR. I'm really interested to look at the 18-120mm f4 LMPZWR. This is a powered zoom lens that Fuji say is actually par focal, which is really impressive if true, given its price. Fingers crossed it lives up to the hype, as this could be a really great video pairing with this camera. For people wanting to adapt lenses onto the X-H2S, there are options from the likes of Metabones that will allow you to either adapt or speed boost third-party lenses. One thing that is missing, however, is a ND adapter, similar to the ones found for RF. E-mount also lacks this, and I really don't understand why, considering both X and E-mount are newer mounts than RF. Fingers crossed we see some options, as using an ND when shooting video is crucial most of the time, and using an adapted lens with a rear-mounted system is a great solution for many people who don't mind manual focusing. The manual focusing experience of the X-H2S depends on the lens you are using. We've only used a handful of lenses with it, but when you are so used to manual focusing, manual focus lenses, going to focus by wire lenses is always a bit weird. However, the tools that sit around manual focusing do make it a much better experience. You have focus peaking as well as a decent punch in, which is still usable while recording as well. The X-H2S also features an updated autofocus system compared to older Fuji cameras. In its stills mode, it performs excellently, and during the time I spent photographing with it, I was very happy with its performance. However, in video mode, I wouldn't say it's 100% reliable just yet. It does a really good job of tracking faces, but it is inconsistent in translating that to focus. It also can focus hunt quite a bit in certain situations. Having to understand what lenses will give you what performance is also a bit of a pain, especially when compared to the modern systems in Sony and Canon cameras now. The X-H2S definitely does lag behind, but it's great to see such a big improvement. Past human tracking, it also has other subject tracking modes, but these are limited to just these subjects. There is no tap object tracking like Canon, for example, which for video use is awesome to have. Hopefully this is something that they can add in future firmware. One nice feature to help with the autofocus performance is the range limiter. This can be helpful for situations where you know your subject is going to be for your recording session, such as an interview. You can then limit the focus range so it doesn't hunt past a given range to give you the best focus performance possible. The X-H2S features a dual memory card slot, one CF Express Type B and one SD card, which will take advantage of V90 speed cards. CF Express Type B is now being used across a good range of cameras, and while it is larger than Type A, which is found in the FX3 and FX6, it is faster and more affordable as of the release of this video. When it comes to stills, if you want the best buffer performance possible, grab a Type B card. However, for video, what you need will depend on what video formats you want to record. But if you want to record everything possible internally, I would suggest just grabbing a CF Express Type B card. Fuji actually have their own compatibility list for both media types, so make sure to check that out when grabbing media for your camera. Having the option to choose between the two is great though, and does mean grabbing media won't break the bank. If you want to record ProRes, you must use CF Express Type B cards, not SD. The camera can also take advantage of this dual slot with a relay writing mode and a dual record mode depending on what format you're in. Another thing with using Type B that people don't consider is how fast you can actually dump cards. Because it's so much faster than SD, you can offload via Thunderbolt, for example, so much quicker. The X-H2S has both a 3.5mm microphone input and headphone output, which is actually pretty common, but the X-T4 actually used USB-C port for audio monitoring with a dongle, so this is good to see. It features the same preamps as the X-T4, and you can use the Tascam audio module designed to communicate with the camera directly via the hot shoe. This would be a key accessory for anyone wanting to shoot better quality audio directly into the camera. You can record 4 channels of audio by using the internal microphone with either the XLR top unit or the microphone in port. This could be good to capture scratch audio while also recording your main audio sources. You can dial the gain of your external mic input all the way down to -30 dB, which could be a good way to get slightly cleaner audio with your external mics. The X-H2S uses the same battery featured in a few other Fujifilm mirrorless cameras, the MPW235. Out of the box, the camera doesn't come with a charger, so you will need to plug the camera in via USB-C with the battery in it to charge it. So if you are planning on grabbing the camera, make sure to grab a charger and maybe a spare battery or two with it. You can also power the camera via this USB-C port, which can be good during longer recording sessions. Fujifilm also makes two battery grips for the X-H2S, which allow you to use two batteries simultaneously for longer runtimes and improved ergonomics for vertical photography shooting. The two different grips are differentiated between the addition of a file transfer function, which includes both wireless and wired LAN, as well as USB smartphone tethering. Fujifilm designed cameras a little differently to other camera brands, and this can take some time to get used to. In the hand, the camera feels incredibly solid and there's a good amount of grip to hold onto when using it handheld. When it comes to monitoring, you have a fully articulating rear LCD and a nice OLED viewfinder. The LCD is decent, but the viewfinder is really good. It's very clear and smooth. It's a well-sized 5.76 million dot OLED EVF, capable of running at 120fps with a 0.8 magnification. Here's a quick rundown of all the buttons across the body, but there are some pretty key things worth highlighting here. There is a range of custom function buttons as well as a bunch of others. On the top, you have a hot shoe, microphone either side of that, and a nice large display screen. When the camera is off, you can see the battery percentage on this little screen. When the camera is on, you see key settings, which is really good, especially if the camera is rigged up with an external monitor or recorder. In regards to I/O, it's pretty simple. You have the full-size HDMI, USB-C for power delivery, and a 3.5mm mic in and headphone out port, as well as a little speaker. The menu system in the X-H2S does lack a good amount of video functions that other camera manufacturers have packed into their cameras now. We have no false color or waveforms, no shutter angle, and other monitoring functions and exposure tools. All you have is zebras, which is a bit of a shame. It's very clearly a menu system designed for stills that has been adapted for video, so I really hope that Fuji keeps on developing this and adding more video-focused features. Looking more at the zebra function, in the menu for this, you have left and right, which is the direction the lines go, but you can only have one toggled at once. You can then set the brightness threshold in 5-stop increments from 50 all the way to 100. This isn't low enough to hit the 38 IRE required for mid-grey for F-Log 2, which is really, really annoying. For clipping, you can set your zebras to 100% in F-Log or 85% in F-Log 2. It's basic, but at least we have this. I just really hope we see some other exposure tools added ASAP, especially a waveform. The flickerless shutter speed setting allows you to dial in your shutter speed in 0.1 increments. This can be really helpful for dialing in your shutter when you are shooting with challenging lights that may flicker on normal shutter speeds. This will allow you to dial out those flickers, which is incredibly useful for this type of camera. The way you adjust your custom white balance is very good. You can adjust the size of the square the camera will reference when setting the white balance, as well as move it about. That way you don't have to worry about filling your entire frame with a grey card, and this is great when using smaller grey cards like Colorbrite's Color Checker Passport, which are really great for traveling filmmakers to use. One thing I did find annoying was how deep in the menu the format function is for your memory cards. This is easily fixed by customizing through the My Menu though. As with any mirrorless camera, a good ecosystem of rigging accessories is pretty crucial. Both Wooden Camera and Small Rig both currently make rigging solutions for the X-H2S, which will provide people with the need for more cinema-orientated rigs. Wooden Camera also makes an extra PL mount adapter, which will work well with their rig for people wanting to use PL lenses with the X-H2S. If you want some more advice on what kit you may need around your next camera purchase, give our experienced sales or tech team a shout via the details in the description below. Our core business revolves around moving image, but I did manage to snap some images with the X-H2S during my holiday down in Cornwall earlier this year. It's a joy to use photographically, and the autofocus really does feel much more reliable than in the video mode. You can shoot stills up to 40fps or 15 when using the mechanical shutter, thanks to the improved readout speed of the sensor. Fuji have also released the X-H2, which is the higher resolution, slightly more affordable brother of the 2S. It has a very similar feature set to the X-H2S, but instead of the 26 megapixel sensor in the 2S, it has a 40 megapixel backside illuminated X-Trans sensor. The X-H2 should have less dynamic range than the X-H2S, due to it being limited to a 12-bit readout versus the X-H2S's 14-bit. The X-H2S should also have a faster readout than the X-H2. The larger resolution sensor in the X-H2 allows for the camera to capture 8K internally, as well as externally. You can also record 6.2K in the X-H2 which is downsampled from 8K, but is limited to 16:9, no 3:2 like you can on the H2S. It can also shoot ProRes internally and features very similar functions to their X2H2S, but at roughly £500 less. It could be a good option for people who'd rather the higher resolution sensor. Whenever you're making a camera purchase, you are going to have to deal with compromise. At this £2,500 price point, there are several options to choose from. You have the Blackmagic Pocket 6K G2 and Pro, Sony FX30, A7 IV, Panasonic S5 and GH6, and they all have different pros and cons. We are planning on doing a comparison video at this price point soon, so make sure to hit subscribe to see that as soon as it releases. However, the X-H2S offers excellent sensor readout speed, dynamic range, image quality, recording formats, and high frame rate options, while being able to capture in Fuji's unique color profiles. It's also an excellent stills camera. This makes it one of the best hybrid cameras available on the market. However, it does need some more video-focused tools and some software tweaks to make the camera better to use for video and cinema workflows. If you want any more advice, don't hesitate to get in contact with us. And if you have any more questions, please let us know in the comments. Let us know what you think of the X-H2S in the comments below. And if you like the video, please give it a like and maybe consider subscribing so you don't miss out on our awesome upcoming content. And thank you so much for watching.